problems than you have now, not less, right? You're bigger, right? So does that mean that that person's not living their dream? No, they are, right? They like that. But it doesn't mean that they're just like sitting on the beach all day doing nothing, right? Usually the most successful people have a lot of stuff going on, right? I have a friend who's extremely wealthy beyond almost anyone's imagination. This guy has problems that I can't even, we're out biking and he's telling me what he's got going on. It just blows my mind. He's in court, like, when you own companies that big, you live in court. He's getting sued for something by somebody just because they know he has a lot of money, right? But he's still living his dream, but his dream comes at a price, right? And he's accepted that. That's the price of his monetary success, right? So let's talk about some of these, because you have to identify whether we're all have a breaking point of how much we're willing to endure. And then it just becomes too much, right? So we have to figure out what are the things we're willing to give up and what are the things are we not, right? So time. If you're going to be successful, you're going to work a lot. I don't know anybody that works 3 hours a day that's killing it, right? Most successful people still work a lot of hours. Are you willing to give up that time? And then that gets compounded when you start adding family in. Like, to live my dream, which was start this, I have missed my kids' entire childhood. I'm never home. I see them 5 days a month for the last decade. They were 2 and 4 when we started this business. I'm weekend dad, right? They know it. We have long conversations about it. I've even had points of guilt where I said, was I a bad dad to you? Because I'm feeling like I abandoned you and it's not your fault. And it's luckily for me, they're understanding. But there's times when I'm not there and they're just like, yeah, you're wrong. That hurts, man. But I'm trying to build something that they can have later, as you went through my vision board, right? And that's what I do. I explain that to them. I don't know if that makes them feel better. Makes me feel better. So you have to say, how much time are you willing to put towards that dream, right? Todd, I know you and I talked last week. I mean, you're there 10 at night wrenching. You're not home with the kids. That hurts. I get it, right? So you have to, energy. What's that? I burn all mine every day. Some people have more energy. Larry has tons of energy just naturally. That's more than me. Like, I can only work so much, and then I have to shut her down. Like, I have a point. I have a breaking point. It's quicker than that. Stress. You're going to have stress. If you're going to try to live your dream, that dream always comes hard. It doesn't, nobody just opens the gates and lets you go, right? There's always, as soon as you make some progress, there's a roadblock. You power through that roadblock and you think, oh, I'm over the hump now. And then you realize there's another hill. And then another one, right? So worry. If you're, no matter what you're doing, you're going to have worry. Right? And stress. It's the same thing. And can you take that? We all have, Jim's definition of success and mine, I'm sure, are not the same, right? So we all have different levels of what we're willing to tolerate, but you have to know what yours are. Like, you have to have those boundaries figured out as part of your creating that vision, right? Television. I don't watch it. I haven't watched it in years. I like television, but I don't like television more than I like trying to reach my goal. So I gave it up. I used to like to play golf. I do not have 6 hours to devote to chasing a white ball around a man-made landscape. Like, it's cool, but I had to give it up. I just couldn't do it. It's just too much time, right? Money issues. If you own a business, even if you don't, you're going to come across money issues at some point. And business owners, I think, have it a lot more than everybody else. Loss of friends. I cannot tell you how many friends I have lost through neglect. Hey, do you want to go do this? Girl, I'm working. Hey, do you want to go next weekend and do this? I would, but I'm working. And then finally, they're like, dude, all you do is work. Forget you. All right. What did I do? I chose my goal or my dream over that person. It doesn't mean I like them less, but they're not on the path. So I had to let them go. I've let a lot of go, a lot of people I really liked. It really hurt. It was a bummer. Like they didn't understand why I worked so much. They didn't have the same drive, right? So that hurts. Family problems, those are the same, it's the same thing. Your family, sometimes your worst critic too. Why are you still doing, because when you're an entrepreneur especially, you're getting your ass kicked all the time, and people are like, they're trying to help you, but they're just telling you to stop. Stop the madness. Why don't you quit and get a regular job? Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? And it's like, you just have to put the blinders on. You say, no, I have a vision, I have a dream, I'm going to stick to that, and everybody else's opinion does not really matter all that much, right? Because that's what's going to make you happy in the end. Like, if you quit because somebody in your family tells you that you should give up your dream, you're going to resent that person for the rest of your life. Right? Do you hear that, Kelly? Tells
and you hold on to it, and they've already fought, they said it, and they moved on.
Yeah, exactly, right?
Hold on to it.
Yeah. Family problems, employees, you know, look. Like, I have two of the most wonderful team members sitting in that other room. Like, they're the best. But not every employee that's ever been in this building is like Leslie and Mike. You get some pieces of work, right? That's worry, stress, all those things, you know. Payroll, as you guys grow, Jim knows, payroll's coming on. Especially when you grow, like, this is what we've experienced, and there's also a diagram that looks a lot similar to what we know in this. It's like, this diagram makes a little off, it's a little optimistic. you know, like when we started, you know, we're here with nothing. And then Larry and I, we climbed up a little bit on, you know, working 90-hour weeks and all that. And then, you know, kind of flattened out for a little bit. And then we started getting a little name. And then we started getting Mike and Nick and all these guys. And we, like, really shot up. And we're like, oh, wow, it's just going to be like this forever. It's not, right? So what happens is that, you know, you start ramping up with staff and people and the thing. And then all of a sudden you start to... I don't know why, but everybody says the same thing. Then there's this dip. And then you start, as your business matures, or whatever it is you're doing, you start to climb again. That could be a decade. That doesn't have to be 6 months, right? You know? I mean, we've seen that. We went like this. This was from year one to year... 5. That's where we're at right now. We're sitting here. Right? And what are we doing? We're depositing in the bank experience, reputation, that Yelp reviews, all the things, right, that will really propel you. You know, my friend Volker, the guy who's really wealthy, he told me that he's never had a business that turned a profit until the year 15. Now, granted, he's trying to build huge businesses, but he's just like, it takes that long to get your systems, your reputation, all these things. Kelly, I saw you drop your head. This is entrepreneurship 101, right? I have spent more nights in the fetal position or on my knees or whatever than I ever thought I would in my whole life. It is what it is, right?
You know what? And I agree with that because Dr. Hayabi is booming now. He's on year 17.
Right. So yeah. I have a good friend that owns a paving business. I think he told me last year they did $60 million, all right, paving driveways. He's on year 23. He didn't start making any real money until year, like, 15. You know, it's just him running around, working 90 hours a week all those years. And then all of a sudden... he's not paving driveways anymore because he's paved so many driveways and he's so good at paving driveways, they're saying, well, come do the Walmart parking lot. Come do the stretch between Haven and Archibald. Like, you know, he's just over all those jobs and all those years, it starts to just boom like that, right? It's what we're trying to do here. We're trying to get good. I mean, it sounds funny. We're on year 11. Like, we're still trying. trying to get good. But we try to get good to the point where they just call us.
Yeah, we're the only option.
Yeah, you want to become the only option. And, you know, the question is, can you withstand this? Well, you'll get through this. Can you withstand this? That's the killer of most dreams. The same thing happens in, doesn't have to be just, could be your career, Mark. You could be killing it for 5 years, and then all of a sudden, you lose a little motivation, they change schools on you, you get a new principal, right? And all of a sudden, you're going, am I living the dream that I went to college for anymore? We've had that conversation, right? And it's the thing is that to get, let's just talk about your teaching career, to get to where you really want to be and go, can you survive that situation until it changes, right? You know, some people do, some people don't. It just depends. So the thing that you have to go home tonight as you're putting your whole vision and goal and realizing that it's not all roses and it never will be. We just have to be realistic with ourselves. Like I used to think, as soon as we get over this hump, we're going to be good. Like I must have said that out loud a million times. And it's like at some point I'm finally like, no, I'm going to get over this hump, and then it's going to go down, and it's going to feel really good, and it's going to go like that again, right?
But I mean, when you're in that area right there, I mean, you're always looking at the bigger picture, right? You have that light at the end of the tunnel.
It's the only thing that keeps you going, to me, right? It's like when it's Wednesday, and you're going, oh my gosh, payroll's in 2 days, I have no idea how we're going to make this or that, right? The stress is starting to crush. That's all I got. I got a $5 cork board and some pictures I printed off the internet. This is what keeps me coming the next day, literally. I have to stand there and go, no, we are going to make it, and you're going to do this, and you're going to do that. And like, it sounds corny, but it's what has gotten me, and I know Larry too, it's what keeps us going. So, you know, the cost issue is a huge component in this whole making your dream happen. And I think getting comfortable with being uncomfortable. You know, Tony Robbins always says, so I'm going to paraphrase Tony Robbins, but he said, the winner is always the one who can, like, withstand the most pain and the most discomfort in the process of getting to the goal. Like, whoever can withstand the most wins, you know? And just having, I never really understood that when I worked for somebody else. I mean, I had goals and dreams, but they're all within the structure of that other person's vision, right? And it was great, but this is bigger than that. And it's deeper than that, too, though. That's what keeps you going. Jim, do you feel this?
I wish my 5 to 11 was only 5 to 11.
There you go.
Mine's more like 7 to 20.